Well, hello everyone, and thanks so much for joining for this fireside chat with Allison Schroeder. What an awesome trailer, and I know a lot of you are going to see the movie tonight. I saw it last night, and I swear it's one of the best movies I've seen, certainly over the last 12 months. It is awesome. So thank you so much for joining us. Just a quick introduction of myself, first of all. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Helen Riley. I'm the CFO here at X, responsible for all of our G&A and BD functions. And it is my great pleasure to, an honor to have been asked to host this fireside chat with Allison. So before we get started, just a quick introduction. So Allison, as you all know, is a screenwriter of Hidden Figures. She attended Stanford, where she studied economics, but also spent a lot of time on math and statistics coursework. You're a financial analyst at Arthur Andersen, forensic analyst at KPMG.
Yes.
And then also got your MFA in, at USC in just focusing on directing and screenwriting.
Everybody else got their MBA. I got my MFA. It does not pay as well in the beginning.
And then, in fact, but your grandparents were actually at NASA, and you also interned there. So when you actually think about those elements of like film and math and, of course, the connection to NASA, I think you're actually the perfect person that could have been picked to actually
this. They did pick me for all those reasons, and I think it turned out good, so.
Well, but I'm not going to be able to do justice to all of your experiences and backgrounds, so I'd love to start off by having you introduce yourself to this group and maybe a connection to the film.
So I'm Allison, and I'm sitting on this lovely pillow because I gave birth 6 weeks ago. Ow. So pardon that. But I grew up in Florida by Cape Canaveral because my grandparents worked there. And my grandfather was actually an engineer for the Mercury capsule. And my grandmother came to deliver lunch one day. And she had raised my father and was bored at home. And she saw a sign that said, learn the two new technology computers. And she was like, well, I can do that. So she became a programmer. And she ended up staying 10 years longer than my grandfather at NASA and worked her way up and ended up being a lead programmer for the shuttle missions. And so I always knew women worked at NASA. And then when I was in eighth grade, they came around to the middle schools and started recruiting dorks like me who were good at math and science. And so for all of high school, I was bussed up to the Cape. And they taught us everything from how to build a circuit board to working on a payload bay experiment. And then I went to Stanford and did economics, which is, you know, heavy in math, and came home for summer and worked for a missile launch company. And they said, oh, we're going to have you file. And I was like, or you could have me do math. And they were like, oh, that's much better for free. So I did math all summer. And that was it. My double major at Stanford, though, was writing and theater.
Sorry.
Because, of course, I have a love of both. And when I graduated, I considered a career in writing, but I was scared. Because you don't make a lot as a writer. And I knew I would have to struggle, and I was really good at math. So I went and I did 2 years as a consultant, and I hated it. And I was doing a litigation case, and they needed some exhibits, and I ended up making a movie for the client. And my boss looked at me and said, oh, for God's sakes, go to film school. So I did. And I graduated, and then it was just a lot of working my way up. I was pigeonholed a lot in teen comedy, because they looked at me and said, well, she can write prom, that's all she can write. But I just kept writing on free different types of movies, and some folks read my Agatha Christie script, and it was the producers of Hidden Figures, because it started out very small. It was just Donna Gelati and her executive, Renee Witt, that was it. There was no Fox, there was no director, there was no big producers other than them, and they read my sample, and I told them everything I just told you. And I pitched a few of the scenes that you saw in that trailer, and they hired me. And now we have a movie.
I'd love to hear a lot more about what actually piqued your interest, especially given the personal connections that you had. And like, what was your personal journey and inspiration
for
doing this?
Well, so I am a pretty big feminist, and I have been doing a lot of activism work in the industry to get women more represented. And I was writing so many scripts that weren't getting made, and you hear actresses say, there aren't any good parts for me. And then you would hear the Bechdel test, and you think, well, yeah, women are always just talking about men. Well, that's not what I do all day. I've got my man in control. I mean, I love him dearly. And so, he really is a great man. I'm sorry, honey. So when I saw this, I thought, okay, three female leads talking about math and science. They're black. So we've got crazy diversity. And I love NASA. I love that this happened there. I love that they broke down barriers first. And I love a story of hope. I think there's a lot of negativity right now, and there's a lot of hate right now. And to be reminded of a time in our history that was really dark, and to see people coming together for a common good and lifting each other up and doing the right thing, I think we need more of. And Hollywood, often for movies like this, it goes very dark, right? And they're kind of depressing, these awards movies. It's hard for me to get through a few of them. And I don't think movies like this are made that often, where it's a little cheesy at times, perhaps, but it's a feel-good movie. And you, when you cry, if you cry, I hope they're happy tears. And if you feel the need to applaud at some moment, please feel free to do so, because it's scene after scene of sort of triumph and victory and overcoming odds, and I think we need more of that. And Katherine Johnson's still alive, so the lead.
98 years old.
Yeah, 98. And her request to give up her life rights was that it couldn't just be about her, that she felt like too much focus was being placed on her, and there were so many other women. And she said Dorothy Vaughan was the smartest woman she ever met, which, if Katherine's saying that, Dorothy was pretty smart. And so from the beginning, it was always these three women. It was always the arcs you see in the film, and it was always them lifting each other up. I don't think there is a single moment in the film where they stab each other in the back or they put the other one down, and I think that that was definitely a conscious effort, you know? And so I've said from the beginning, it's a bit of my love letter to feminism. It's a bit of a love letter to all my female friends and to diversity and reclaiming history. I hope we did it.
Yeah, Katherine is an incredible, inspiring figure in this movie.
Yeah.
I know you mentioned when we spoke earlier you hadn't met her, but you did actually have conversations with her on the phone. I'd love to hear more about what those conversations were about and how she influenced your thinking as you were developing the script.
I was never allowed access to Katherine, so it all had to go through the author. So I would give the questions to the author, and then the author would go ask her and come back to me. The main things were her humility. So she's like, I don't know what all the fuss is about. All I did was just keep showing up. And it's like, that's actually a really big deal. To keep showing up when people are treating you this way is huge. And I don't think we give enough weight or importance to that. And she says, well, you know, I was never outspoken. I just kept asking politely. And it's like, yeah, you did. And you, every day, I don't want to ruin the movie, but there's a scene where she keeps asking to get into a meeting. And in real life, this really happened. And she just waited in that hallway day, and it's just, could I come to the meeting today? Could I come, for like months? And finally, her boss was just like, oh, for God's sakes, like, get in the room. And so when you see that in the film, like, it's true, and it's not maybe what we're used to seeing in a Hollywood film. This is a much more subtle movie about racism and sexism and standing up for yourself, but I think it's more true to what we actually experience in the world. So that was her big thing, and she was humble. She had quiet dignity. Taraji nails all her mannerisms. And then also doing, honoring her marriage was very important, because he was a wonderful man and incredibly supportive.
Can you speak a little more about that? I mean, that was definitely one of the themes that struck me from watching the movie, was the importance of sponsors. The role that sponsors played for the women, and also the support network they have, and that came through really powerfully. I'm curious what your experience has been in your personal life. You've obviously referenced your husband already.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think that it was key. I mean, Mary Jackson's husband cooked every dinner so that she could stay late at NASA. And then, you know, Katherine's mother, they moved her to a school so that she could go. So their families and their communities uplifted them, and then their white bosses uplifted them and supported them, which again, like, how many times have you been watching a movie and you're waiting for the boss to hit on the girl, right? And it happens and we're used to it. It doesn't happen. It's not gonna happen in this film. There's no way we were gonna let that happen. And that's because in real life, these bosses were very respectful and they treated these women great. So I was single for a long time and was waiting for a man myself that could handle my ambition. And turns out younger men are wonderful. So I met him at the Writers Guild and I have a fractured tailbone and extreme anemia. And so my husband just has been wonderful with the baby, and literally, like, I can't even sit up half the time. This is narcotics. I'm very excited. I'm on Vicodin right now. So I can sit before you. But, you know, I went to the premiere 3 weeks after giving birth and left my husband alone with our daughter, and he was the one kicking me out the door. Go, go, you have to go. You can't miss this. And I think, I don't care if you're a man or woman, I don't care your race, that's what you need to succeed, I think, in life, is that support system. And you need that person saying to you in your low moments, when you don't want to get out of bed, you can do this, and you can go, and you can make this happen. And that's what these women did for each other. At some point in this film, each of them is almost ready to give up. And they turn to the other one and say, you gotta keep going. And I think that's what we all need. So it's not a, there's a lot of messages in this movie, but it's what I strive to do in my writing, which is look at the good. I don't wanna spend too much time dwelling on the bad. And as you can tell from my personality, I also like a certain sense of humor because I think it gets us through the low, and that the film also has that.
So exactly on that theme, you know, hopefully everyone will have seen the movie by the end of today. What would you like us to take away from it? There are a lot of hidden messages and more explicit messages throughout the movie, but you know, if there are two or three things that you want people to take away from the movie, what would those be?
My big thing is notice your neighbor. Notice the person sitting next to you and get to know them and see if there's something that you can do to help them succeed. And I think we don't do that a lot of times. We're so consumed with how do I succeed, how do I make it forward, and we have our blinders on, and I think we need to be more open to it, you know? And Jamie invited me here today, and it was so funny at lunch, like, she had just listened to me so well when we were at this Google retreat, and she knew every single story that I told her, and I was like, she's a listener, and that's what makes a great boss. Honestly. And that's what you all need to do, is you need to listen to each other.
You've touched on personal experiences that you've had that actually filtered through in your writing and...
Oh. I'm too silent. I never am too silent. Yes.
It may just be the mic as well. but personal experiences. So one example is the classroom scene where I think it's Mary.
Oh, right, right.
I'll leave it to you to actually tell the scene and then actually your experiences that led to that appearing in the movie.
One of the fun things about writing this is things haven't changed that much in a certain extent. So there's a scene that you're going to see where Janelle shows up for class, and it's what happened to me. So I was studying abroad at Oxford, and I showed up for international economics, and I walked in, and the professor was like, oh, you know, English lists down the hall. And I was like, no, this is what I'm here for. And he said, I don't know how to teach a woman. And I said, it's just like teaching a man, and sat my ass down. It's fun. So Janelle does that. And there were many times that people tried to cut that scene from that movie. And I said, listen, you better keep that scene. And so when you see it, I think it resonates because it's not that far fetched from now. And there's a lot, honestly, there's a lot. There's a church scene where they're hooking Catherine up. And that's just my friends. That's how deep, you know, mischievous we are with each other. And I think how women relate to each other. There's a lot of fun that we have with each other and a lot of humor that I don't often see in movies. So their comradeship is very much, you know, based on just how I joke around with my friends as well. We don't drink bathtub gin, but but so that was, so all those experiences and There's a scene where Janelle's heels get caught in the grate of a wind tunnel, and that was something that happened to my grandmother. And my grandmother would talk about like the dress code at NASA, and so that was a part of it. And the other one that I have to give to the costume designer and everyone is, these women look fantastic. And too often the stereotype is frumpy, nerdy, awkward. Janelle Monáe is fierce. You know what I mean? And I think that's important too, because we have to break these stereotypes. And I feel like one of the things I noticed was when I got to Stanford and I was a dancer and I did the musical and I was blonde and scrawny and bubbly and perky, and these are not adjectives that a mathematician is normally given. And so when I said that I was going to major in economics and I was taking calculus, the boy down the hall said, "Don't you think you should take the slower phase calculus?" I said, "No," but I did hesitate for a second because I'd gone to a public high school in Florida, you know, nothing fancy, and he'd gone to a boarding school, and he said, "Well, you know, you're probably not gonna last as an economics major." At which point I said, "If you speak to women this way, you're probably not gonna get laid." He was not used to such sarcasm. We did not speak again, but he ended up being a poli-sci major, didn't he? And I majored in economics.
One thing that's really striking about the movie, so it's set in the 50s and 60s, and the women face these incredible obstacles because of their race, because of their gender. There's overt bias as well as the unconscious bias. And things have definitely improved over time, but you know, we're now 2017, and we look at the stats and women in technology, women in Hollywood, and it's better than it was, but there's still a lot of challenges that women face. Why do you think that is, and what do you think needs to happen to accelerate change?
We need to, it's got to be from a young age. So the reason that I'm still in Hollywood is my parents, and in some ways growing up by NASA, right? So I was good at math and science at a young age. And, okay, when I was in kindergarten, I did a science fair project, right? And my dad came in and he wanted to help me. And I explained to my father that I did not need his help. And I did it all on my own, and I took the little board down and I put it in. And that night the judges did the judging and the doors were locked, and I peeked in the window and there was the blue ribbon on my science project. And the next day I showed up to school so excited, and I ran into the room and it had been replaced by honorable mention. And I didn't understand why, and my parents didn't understand why, and they said, "Oh, well, the judges found out that it was a kindergartner girl, and this is K through three, and we realized she couldn't have done it on her own. And so we took the ribbon away from her." Ooh. Now, my dad went ballistic. And that was a defining moment in my life, right? I'm a kindergartner that learns the injustice of the world. Pretty sure I was pissed off about it. And that could have affected me two ways. I could have given up, or I could have said, "I'm gonna show you all." And I decided to show them all. And I think that's what little girls need, is in that moment, when that happens at a young age, someone saying, "That's wrong, that's not okay, and you deserved that, and you're not giving up," and you show up the next year at the science fair.
I know that we have some aspiring screenwriters actually at X, so I don't know whether we have any in the room right now, but I think it'd be great to hear whether you've got any words of wisdom or advice for anyone who is interested in screenwriting.
I think if there is anything else in the world you think you can do, go do it, because screenwriting is really brutal and really hard, and there are so many people clamoring. And it has to be like your biggest dream ever to make it, because you're going to get told no a lot. But if it's your biggest dream ever, then go for it and expect 2 to 8 years to see results.
Okay, I think we had a question.
Hello, I'm so excited to meet you in person. So I went and saw the film screened by the SF Film Society. And just knowing your background with the quantitative skills and film passion, how did you incorporate both of those when writing the film? So did you have a formula or was it all emotional based? Just what was that process?
I actually do break story in Excel, which is a really weird thing. So there is a certain structure that I like to follow. I'm very, very big on structure, and I think you should hit certain beats on certain pages. So that's sort of the analytical side of me. And then everything else is emotion. In the beginning, I used to plan my writing a lot more, and as I've done so many scripts at this point, I just start writing because I need to discover the movie as I'm going along to maintain my interest in it and my excitement, and it's amazing what you can find that way where my characters take me. So it's a little bit of both, honestly. But for this one, it was just pulling from my own experiences a lot of the time.
Nice, thank you.
Yeah.
When did you first realize you wanted to be a screenwriter? Given the advice you just gave, that it's something that you really have to be passionate about, and earlier you said that you were actually pursuing a different career to begin with, so what made you change?
I started out in theater. I did a lot of musicals, and I started out in short story science fiction. There's not a lot of money there. And then I did plays and musicals, and I would get sad when it ended because there was no permanent record. And that's when I realized maybe my medium was film. And so I loved the idea. I also loved the idea of the writing turning into something visual, and I love being on set, and I love actors, and I love production design. I love all that. So that's when I decided if I was going to go into writing, it would be screenwriting. And then it was honestly just being in finance. I could do the job. I was relatively good at the job, but I wasn't the best at the job. And it wasn't really a challenge for me. And the hardest profession I think I could have personally chosen was being a screenwriter. And I love a challenge. So, of course, I went for the hardest one. And I still.
Clearly, no regrets?
No, it's funny. Well, at my 5-year reunion, I was pitied. So, at my 5-year reunion, I was a production assistant and I was making $480 a week. And my friends went, "You mean an hour?" And I was like, "No, lawyer, I mean a week." At which point, everyone jumped and paid for my meal. And they felt really sorry for me because they had expense accounts and first class and suits and, you know, they were CEOs. And at my 10-year reunion, I was the envy of everyone because a lot of them were bored at their jobs. They'd peaked. They'd reached their promotion level. They felt like they were just in the suburbs with kids. And I was like, you know, writing a TV show. There's always the next mountain for me to climb in this job. There's always the next obstacle. There's always the next project. And it was such a fascinating switch, you know. And I think that's honestly when I knew I'd made the right decision, because I will love this job always. I can't imagine doing anything else.
What do you love most about it? What is it that gives you that passion for it?
It's never the same every day. I get to be creative. I get to hopefully reach people in change period, but it's the constant challenge. I mean, I'm working on 7 projects right now, right? And I haven't booked a single one, but you have to pitch, right? So one is a children's story about a Bigfoot, right? And it's about body image issues. And then one is a reimagining of a famous fairy tale. And then one is this psychological thriller set in the 1920s. And you're given these imperfect ideas, and you have to solve the problems and turn them into stories. And I love that. I love that puzzle. And I'm still a big dork, and when I get on set, I mean, there's nothing like it for me. That energy, that excitement, hearing action. I'm going to direct. You know, I went to USC for directing and writing, and so it's been a few years since I directed, and I really want to get back to it. It's magic on set. I don't know if any of you have ever been, but it's pretty magical.
Sounds magical. Another question.
Are there any themes or particular aspects of the relationship between the women in this movie that you originally had the idea of, oh, this is probably going to be in there, and then as you started finding out about the real historical situation or characters realized that it wasn't historically accurate, and so you had to shelve that?
It was actually the opposite, interestingly. So I did a lot of research. I mean, I took this incredibly seriously. So Margot dropped something like 1,000 documents into a Dropbox for me. And it was everything from like housing surveys to Jim Crow law, like arguments in court to their obituaries. And so my first draft, I was just so rigorous with the truth and the timeline of what had happened that I wasn't getting the right feel of comradeship and fun between them. Their arcs have always remained the same. The set pieces have always remained the same. But when I turned in the draft, Donna just said, okay, you've got the facts, now go have fun. And I think that's, in a way, where the writing really started. And so that's more what it was. And some of the details started to fade in my head so I could start to fudge things a little bit. You know, like, I have an incredible respect for STEM. And so in real life, it took Katherine Johnson, you know, 4 days to run the numbers. Well, that's not exciting in film. So, you know, it's okay to truncate that to 4 hours. Does it drive me a little bit crazy that you think that they're running the tracking room in Langley like Mission Control in Cape Canaveral? Yes, but you can't have the characters say something and then they relay it and you cut to the base. Like, that would just be silly in a movie. So I had to let go of some of that and say it's about the story overall and not every fact has to be perfect, you know?
Okay, another question.
Hello, thank you. You touched earlier on this unconscious bias that pretty girls can't be smart and smart girls can't be pretty. How did you combat that? And what would you say that we should all be doing more of to kind of break that down for the future?
I have seen women, and I myself have dumbed myself down occasionally. I remember when I was going out for jobs in the industry, I had financial analysts listed, and I could not get a job to save my life. And the moment I took it off and I put like intern, suddenly they would hire me. I remember being conscious of, I am still conscious of what I wear to meetings, but so if I go in for an action film, I'm going in jeans, boots, and a rocker jacket, right? If I'm going in for a teen comedy, I might get to wear a dress. I am very aware of the image that I'm putting out there, but I am still a woman, and if I want to wear badass boots with heels, I'm going to wear them, and I'm going to own them. So I think that's a part of it. I think we need to not dumb ourselves down, and I think we need to not hide our femininity. And it's something that now that I'm further along in my career, I have the luxury of doing. You know, my agents didn't tell them I was pregnant. And so I would roll up to a meeting like 7 months pregnant, right, in a dress. And the execs would go, oh God, like, do you need a seat? But by not giving them a time to think about the ramifications of me being pregnant, they didn't have time to think about it, and the meeting just went on as it was. Whereas I think if they'd known ahead of time, they'd think, oh, she's going to have to take maternity leave, or what does that mean? So not compromising, being the woman you are, and just keep showing up and changing the way they see you. You know, I love to dress up. Do you know what I'm looking forward to about this award season? The dresses. And that's okay. You know, like, that's okay. I'm a woman. I can be a woman and a writer and successful. So if we stop compromising, I think that's the key.
Another question.
So you say that being on set is magic. I'm curious, with a movie like this with three strong female leads, if the feeling on set was a different kind of magic for this movie.
Okay, so on a set, there's a lot of jaded people, right? You've got grips and electrics and ADs that have done this for years, right? And none of the movie stars impress them anymore, right? When you showed up on this set, everyone was excited. and the departments would talk to each other, and they'd say, can you believe we're doing this? No, can you believe we're doing this? Did you see that scene? Did you know that this was real? And I, of course, clearly just love to talk, so I would talk to every department, and that was really rare. There was a pride. There was a sense of, I can't believe we're really doing this. I mean, this, you're going to see scenes in this, you're like, did they really get away with that? And so that was the most magical thing. And then when the first take of the three of them that I saw was in the cafeteria scene, and they were so in character, and the moment they yelled cut, all three of them burst into their real selves and started harassing each other. That was awesome. And then the moment at the end with Taraji's triumph, again, she's Taraji, and then they hit roll, and she just morphs. And she said the line, and I like teared up, and I said, okay, this is gonna work. And that's what I mean by magic. It's that moment it goes from everybody joking around and everybody to, in the blink of an eye, total in character, you know? And that, I think, that's the magic. The other magic that is a huge responsibility as a writer for any of you aspiring is you are the blueprint for 100 to 200 people, and that's a huge responsibility. So if you casually write that it happens to be Halloween that night, understand that that is an art department and a costume department and a production design suddenly turning that neighborhood into Halloween. And that's a huge ask. And that happened to me on Mean Girls too, when I showed up and I just thought, oh God, did it really need to be Halloween in this flashback? Because you just had to decorate like 16 houses. And so that's also like, that's a magical thing when you show up and someone's made your vision come to life. So take that responsibility seriously.
We have time for one more question. Go ahead.
On the topic of financial success in Hollywood, and how do you see that the last two big Star Wars movies did have a female protagonist, and how that relates to the future of action and big AAA movies?
I think it's huge. I think it's, I mean, but there was still backlash on it. I mean, you remember when it was announced, but I think it's absolutely huge. I think it's a game changer. I think that I really do hope the industry has changed. However, I will admit that I pitch action films all the time with female leads, and I get a lot of pushback. And they don't think it's financially viable. And what they will say to me when I point out, what about Rogue One, is they'll say, well, it's Star Wars, it doesn't count. If I say, well, what about Hunger Games? Oh, but it was a best-selling novel, that doesn't count. So there's always still a qualifier, and that's a sad thing. It doesn't count because it was a franchise first, and people are buying the franchise, not the female lead. So what it's going to take is things like Bridesmaids, right, which is in a completely original, and you can't say, oh, it was only successful because the brand. Something like this, if it succeeds, you can't say, well, it's because there's action figures of these women. Like, no. So I think they're actually maybe Legos now, but, you know, they came after the fact. That's the difference. There's always an excuse in Hollywood, and what we have to do is keep showing these successes to take away the excuses. But I get it all the time. I pitched a movie where I pitched the whole thing, and at the end they were like, that's great. Can both of the leads now be changed to men? And I was like, well, technically yes, but no. You know, and those are also battles you have to choose when to say yes and when to say no to as a writer as well.
Okay. I think we're almost at time now. Please, everybody, join me in thanking Allison for being here today, especially she just had a baby 6 months. We're enormously grateful. I mean, just had a baby 6 weeks ago. I know you fractured your tailbone. The movie is out today, and yet Allison still really wanted to be here with really us today. So enormous thanks. I also want to make a shout out to Jamie Wadu, who actually made the introduction and enabled this event to happen. And to continue our support of women of color in tech, we've also invited 30 girls from Black Girls Code who'll be joining us at the movie. So please welcome them to this movie screening and introduce yourselves. I'm sure they would love to meet some exes. And everybody, enjoy the film.
Enjoy.
All right, thanks everyone.